Hi there, my name is Jason Harlow. Today I'd like to go over chapter 12 on static equilibrium by Richard Wolfson. And there's four sections. Conditions for equilibrium. These conditions are that the net force is zero and that the net torque is zero. Center of gravity. This is how we compute the torque due to gravity. So we use the center of gravity, which is the same as the center of mass, actually. Static equilibrium problems, we'll do a couple of examples of that today. And lastly, stability. Stability is where you have something in equilibrium, but if you disturb it a little bit, does it accelerate away, or does it want to return back to equilibrium? And we talked about this a little bit at the end of chapter 7, if you remember. So the quote up above says that the key to the engineer's success in designing this Alamillo bridge, which is in Spain, and making sure it doesn't topple to the left like it looks like it's going to, is static equilibrium, the condition in which a structure experiences neither a net force nor a net torque. So let's get started. Okay, so the conditions for static equilibrium, it's pretty simple. It's the object undergoes neither rotational nor linear acceleration, meaning if it's at rest, not moving, it remains at rest. And the conditions in terms of equations are that if you have several forces where this index I can go 1, 2, 3, 4, you sum up the vector of all those forces, you get 0. And we're sort of used to that. We've been doing that for a few chapters now. But the new thing is that you also sum up the torques. So the net torque is the sum of all the torques. One torque would be where the force was applied. Vector product times the force itself. And so you sum those all up and you get the net torque is zero. And when you're finding the origin for these vectors R, that's called the pivot point, right? And so if something's rotating, you choose the pivot point to be where it's rotating about. If it's not rotating, you're in static equilibrium, then you may choose the pivot point to be wherever you want. So we tend to choose a convenient point where we don't want to evaluate torques. And I'll show you an example of that coming up next. Okay, so we have a raised span of a drawbridge shown has its 11,000 kilogram mass distributed uniformly over its 14 meter length. And it says, find the magnitude of the tension in the supporting cable. And so the other thing we know is the length is 14 meters. So we know that our three equations are going to be the net force in the x direction is zero, the net force in the y direction is zero, and the net torque is zero. And what's drawn here is what's called an extended free body diagram. So it's like a free body diagram. You draw the forces acting on this object, but now it matters where those forces act. So you have to draw a little sketch of that drawbridge as that diagonal line. And then we draw the tension force as acting on the upper right corner there, down to the left, 15 degrees. The gravity force we know acts downward, it's mg, and that acts on the center of gravity of the object. So that's going to be 7 meters up and right in the middle there. And then there's a third force, which is the force from the hinge on the left-hand side, which is probably pointing up and to the right. And we don't know much about that hinge force, so let's keep that in mind. So of those three equations, I think I'm going to start with the torques. And so the net, we'll set net torque equals zero. As for the pivot, we'll choose the pivot equals the hinge because we don't know this F sub H, the what the hinge force is. And the next thing I have to do is choose a direction for the torque. Let's choose a convention that counterclockwise around this pivot point will be positive. So since the pivot is at the hinge, the force of the hinge exerts no torque because the lever arm there is zero. So the net torque is just the torque from the tension force, which will be positive, and then plus the tension from the gravity force, which is going to be clockwise there, so it'll be negative. Okay, so let's look at the tension force. It's down and to the left 15 degrees, and the lever arm is 14 meters up, so there's, and that's 30 degrees, so there's a 15 degree angle there between the 14 meters and the tension force. So the torque there is 14 times T times sine of 15 degrees. As for gravity, gravity is acting straight down, 7 meters away from the pivot. So there's a 60 degree angle between the gravity force and that 7 meters. So you're minusing off 7 times the mg times sine 60. And writing that out again, that's the 0 is the net torque equals these things. Solving for t, I get 7 times the mass there, times g, times sine 60, and then divided by the 14 meters times sine 15. Plugging all that into my calculator, I get 1.8 times 10 to the 5 newtons. Okay, let's see if you've got the basic idea. The figure here shows an object with 3 pairs of forces acting on it shown, with the length of these vectors being proportional to the magnitude of the forces. Which pair, if it was the only forces acting on the object, would result in static equilibrium? The A1 plus A2, the B1 plus B2, or the C1 plus C2? I'll let you think about that. Press pause, and then we'll resume. I'll tell you the answer. Okay, so let's look at A1 plus A2. So A1 plus A2, they're in opposite directions. They have this same lever arm. If the pivot was in the middle, in between them, they both have zero torque. And so the torques are zero, but A2 is bigger than A1, so there'll be a net force accelerating this object towards the right. So that's not equilibrium. As for B1 and B2, it looks like actually in this case the forces do balance because they're equal and opposite. But now if you put a pivot point in the middle here, B2 would be a clockwise torque, B1 would be also a clockwise torque, and the whole thing's going to rotate clockwise. So that's not static equilibrium. It's only C1 and C2. These are connected along the same line, so any pivot along this line will have zero torques from both. And they're equal and opposite forces, so the net force is also zero. Okay, center of gravity. The gravitational force acts on all parts of an object, and each little part of the object has a little gravitational torque. These forces, if you integrate, all act like a single force equal to the object's weight acting at a point called the center of gravity. And in a uniform gravitational field, like here near the surface of the Earth, the center of gravity coincides with the center of mass. So we did that implicitly when we had the drawbridge in the previous example. We took the gravity as if it was acting right at the center of mass of the drawbridge. This gives a way of finding where the center of gravity is, because if you support any weirdly shaped object at some point and just hang it from the ceiling, I guess, if the center of gravity is not underneath that pivot, then what'll happen is gravity will exert a torque and rotate it until it is underneath that pivot. And that's where it will come to equilibrium. And then you can change and look at a different place where you hang it from a different side, and again, the center of gravity will come right underneath it, and then the intersection of these two lines will be the center of gravity of that object. That's a nice little trick. Let's do another question. The dancer in the figure is balanced, so she's in static equilibrium. Which of the 3-lettered points, A, B, or C, do you think is her center of gravity? Maybe pause it, think about that, and I'll tell you the answer. Okay, it was point B. So the idea there is that gravity is going to pull downwards at the center of gravity, and there's a pivot point, which is her toe, down here. So it's only B that'll have a zero net torque, gravity torque, around that pivot point. And so she won't rotate. Okay, let's do a really classic example. You have a ladder that is leaning against a frictionless wall. And it says the coefficient of static friction with the ground is mu. And the question you're asked is, what is the maximum angle, phi, shown down there, so that the ladder will not slip? So looking at this ladder, you're going to have two normal forces acting on it. The one from the ground we'll call N1, and the one from the wall we'll call N2. Gravity pulls from the center of gravity downwards. There's no friction on that wall, but down here at the base, It's going to want to slip to the left, I think, so the static friction force there will be to the right. And we've drawn all those forces on that extended free body diagram to the right. And we're going to set F net and the X is 0, F net and the Y is 0, and the net torque is 0. Okay. So, when will the ladder slip? It'll be what angle? Will be when the static friction force is equal to the maximum static friction force, which is the coefficient of friction, static friction, times the normal force at the base there, N1. So F net in the X direction is negative N2 from the wall plus this FS max. So it's going to be negative N1, negative N2 plus mu sum times N1. Set that equal to 0. Let's call that equation 1. F net in the y direction is the gravity downwards plus the normal force 1 upwards. We'll call that, set that equal to 0. We'll call that equation 2. And now let's look at the torques. We'll choose the bottom of the ladder to be the pivot point. And let's choose counterclockwise rotation around that pivot to be positive torques. So what do we have? We have the wall, N2, as a distance L away from the pivot, and there's the angle phi. And we have the gravity, which is a distance L over 2 from the pivot, and the angle there is 90 minus phi between gravity and that distance. So the net torque, remember it's positive for the wall, and it's going to be negative for the gravity by our definition. So we're going to get torque from net N2 minus the torque from gravity. So it's N2 times L times sine phi minus the mg times L over 2 times sine of 90 minus phi. That's all equal to 0. Next step is, you should know from geometry, I guess, that sine of 90 minus phi can be written as cosine of phi. It's the same thing. So solving this out, rearranging, that's our equation. There's L's on both sides of that equation, so they'll cancel. You get tan sine phi over cos phi is tan phi. That's mg over 2 n2. Equation 1 says that n1 was mg, and equation 2 said that n2 was mu times n1. So that's mu times mg, and we plug that in to that equation for tan phi. We get tan phi is mg divided by 2 mg. Mg's cancel, and there's a mu there. That's 1 over 2 mu. So phi can be found as inverse tan of 1 over 2 mu. That's the maximum angle you can lean that wall up and not have it slip. Okay, so the last section in chapter 12 here is stability. An equilibrium, as we've just found, which would be when the net force and net torque is 0, an equilibrium is stable if a slight disturbance from equilibrium results in forces and or torques that tend to restore the equilibrium. So a cone on its base, for example, if you nudge it one way or the other, it wants to fall back to the way it was. Whereas an equilibrium is unstable if a slight disturbance causes the system to accelerate away from its original equilibrium. A cone upside down here, you tip it a little bit, then the gravitational torque will take over and want to tip it more and more. So if you make a plot of potential energy versus distance and look at a ball or something, a little disturbance will cause it to go back and forth and oscillate around its equilibrium position. That's called stable equilibrium. If it's a convex up, so this is concave up, convex up, potential versus distance graph means that as it goes away, its kinetic energy will increase and it will rush away from that point, so it'll leave its equilibrium. If the potential energy is a flat curve there, that's called neutrally stable equilibrium. A little disturbance will allow it to go away, but it won't speed it up. And then there's something called a metastable, or a conditionally stable equilibrium, so that if the disturbances are small, it does return, but if the disturbance is bigger, it'll go over the hump and escape and be unstable. So to be in equilibrium, there must be a zero net force on an object. So that means that the object must be at a maximum or a minimum of its potential energy curve. So we'd say du by dx equals 0 for a one-dimensional system. For stable equilibrium, the object must be at a minimum, which means that the second derivative is greater than zero. That's that convex, concave up situation. And then the unstable equilibrium is when the second derivative of u is less than zero. That's your convex up. And it is possible in 2D to have second derivative which is positive in one way but then negative in the other way. And so it's like a saddle. And so this is a point that's stable in one direction, but it's actually unstable in another direction. And that's it for chapter 12. And I'll see you in class.